And Counselor Reed?
Here.
Thank you. Would you all please join me in the pledge to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are you all there?
Yes.
Excuse us. Slight problem here. We have a number of presentations this evening. I just wanted to see if any of the people being presented to were going to be in the audience. Okay. Recognize them, and I guess in lieu of their being here tonight, why don't we wait then until next month to do that, when presumably they may be back in school and some of them may be able to join us. Is there anybody here representing the boys lacrosse team? Ditto on that one. Is Ned Strizziero here? I don't do too well, but not. Lindsay, you're it. Come on down. Town of Cape Elizabeth has a special recognition this evening. This is for Lindsay Lewis, who was announced in the Maine Sunday Telegram recently as Maine's most valuable player for the 1995-1996 girls' soccer. And this is from the entire state. And you know how very proud we are of you, and you know how much some of us are looking forward to seeing you continue your career in college. Carefully. Okay? Well done. Mr. Chappell.
Yeah, I want you to come down here again. I waited until you got to sit down so you can get up again. The RWS at their annual meeting every year give out sweatshirts. So we always figured it was nice here at Cape Elizabeth if we could bring one back to the chairman of the council for their continued support of RWS over the past 12 to 14 years. We're one of the towns that does up in the top three of 31 in recycling every year. We can be very proud of it, and it's been the council's support of this program that's made it possible. So I always take the liberty, when they give these out to the group, of getting an extra one. I try to get one large enough. It's good for jogging, good for the beach, and good for pajamas. This goes to Janet McLaughlin.
Thank you, Irv. Now have council reports and correspondence. Councilor Jordan?
I just want to add a little something to what I attended, along with a manager and a former RWS rep, Lester Jodd, to the annual meeting and this year, and we had a very good time, and I think everything went well. And the new officers for this coming year is Jim Soule from South Poland. He's a former mayor and councilor of South Poland. He's president, business manager, Kevin Klein as Vice President from Poland. And the next gentleman is Honest Abe, as far as Cape Elizabeth is concerned. Irv Chappell is the treasurer for the IWS for this coming year. And that's all I have.
Great. Thank you for sharing that with us. Congratulations, Mr. Chappell. We know you'll serve us really well. Any other reports and correspondence? Councilor Linnell?
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chairman. I'll make this quick. Actually, a number of weeks ago, I went to Omaha, Nebraska, as Maine's representative to the National League of Cities on Energy and Environment and Natural Resources. And there's a meeting out there. They have fantastic steaks. We got a tour of the Strategic Air Command facility there, and I can't tell you any more than that. Thank you.
Thank you for that classified report. Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman and members of the audience in the room and on TV, I'm suffering from a back injury and will have to stand and move. I don't want anyone to take my gestures to be a response to anything that I am seeing or hearing, and I will have to leave my seat and stand. And again, I would please ask that people understand that it is not an act of not paying attention, but otherwise I couldn't be here, and I'm sure no one would want me not to be, so I'm here on those conditions. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? Councilor Cogshill?
Yes, I just wanted to let people know that the council chairman has appointed me to represent the town of Cape Elizabeth along with representatives of South Portland, and the Greater Portland Chamber of Commerce to be on a committee for a bridge opening ceremony steering committee. And as things progress, I will keep you informed.
Thank you. Anybody else? A few items to share with the audience and with the council. We had correspondence from the assessor in our packet for this evening's meeting announcing that the tax rate has been set at $18.56 per thousand. The bills will be going out very shortly. First payment is due October 4th. The second payment is due April 4th. Now on to good news. The zoning ordinance rewrite review is progressing. The next three meetings, and councilors may want to take note of these, especially if you weren't joining us in our recent evening, are August 26th, September 3rd, and September 18th. That is being conducted jointly with the Planning Board and the Town Council. Following last month's meeting and the discussion about playing fields at Fort Williams especially, we have established an informal working group to draft some language relative to permanently dedicating areas of Fort Williams for passive recreation and open space. And I'm expecting that group to bring its recommendations to the council at its September meeting. Those of you who have visited the transfer station lately have seen a lot of earth movement going on there, a lot of changes. There was a recent article in the newspaper. The manager assured me today that we are not putting, what was it?
36.
We are not putting 36 inches of loam on top of that, regardless of what was announced in the newspaper, something much more reasonable. And for those of you who are here this evening, you have been able to access the town hall, hopefully in a little safer situation than we may have had in the past, and that work is just about finished, I believe. So those of you who've had to come to town hall recently, we appreciate your patience very much for letting us accommodate the access points to make them safer for everybody. I would like now a motion on the minutes of meeting number 4 held on July 8, 1996.
I move we accept the minutes as written.
Thank you.
I'll second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. At this point in the agenda, we have a time for citizens' discussion of items that are not on this evening's agenda. If there's anybody who would like to take advantage of that, would you please come to the microphone and give us your name and address? Yes, sir.
Howard Littlefield, 6 Lawson Road, Cape Elizabeth.
The item I'd like to bring up is one that's been brought up before, but not been brought up, is since we only have a blinking light at the intersection of Ocean House and Shaw Road and Scott Dyer, I'd like to see the council address making Scott Dyer to Hill Street one-way, therefore avoiding the oncoming traffic turning onto Ocean House Road so you don't have a crossing, and all the traffic would go down Hill Street and then onto Ocean House Road and then up by Shaw Road, and therefore avoiding a crisscrossing traffic trying to get from Shaw Road to Scott Dyer Road. Scott Dyer Road to Shaw Road.
Right. Thank you very much. Put that into the mix. Is there anybody else who'd like to take advantage of this time? Okay, seeing none, we will proceed with the consent agenda. We have this evening four items on the consent agenda. Number 44 is acceptance of $67,188 in local road assistance funds from the Maine Department of Transportation. Number 45 is acceptance of $9,864 in paving funds from Maine Department of Transportation. Number 46 is the acceptance of donation from Rotary Club for landscaping the Joan Benoit Samuelson statue on the grounds of the library. And number 47 is the request to use Fort Williams Park from New Hampshire Pyrotechnics Association in conjunction with L.P. Murray for September 21st, 1996. That one comes with a couple of conditions, namely that there will be no blasting or shots except between 6 p.m. and 9 p.m., and that all publicity is to be approved by the town manager. Is there any councilor who wishes an item to be removed from the consent calendar? Councilor Jordan.
You want to remove, or can you discuss any one?
You need to remove it for discussion.
Okay. What I'm concerned about, and I would like to have some discussion somewhere along the line about the Joni Benoit, what is laid out here on this paper, of the design of it.
Okay, we'll remove that and have that for discussion.
Yes, that's what I would like.
Thank you, Councillor. Anything else anybody would like to have removed? I would entertain a motion for items 44, 45, and 47 for approval as consent calendar. Councilor Nell.
Madam Chair, I move that, that we move the consent agenda items 44, 45, and 47 as written.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? 7-0.
May I interrupt to announce that there is a red automobile out on the parking lot with its headlights on. It's 65675S, a red NX 1600.
Someone just left. Thank you. Thank you very much. The item 46, again, donation from Rotary Club for landscaping the Joan Benoit Samuelson statue, and the council did receive in its packet a landscaping plan. Mr. McGovern, do you want to give some information on that?
Yes, be happy to. If anyone in the audience would like to see what we're discussing, it's on that board over there in the front corner. You might want to walk over and take a closer look. For some time, the town council has wanted to improve the landscaping of the Joan Benoit Samuelson statue or sculpture. This particular design was developed by Ed McElhaney, who I think is known to many people as a very prominent landscaper in the community. The intention is to have benches for people to be able to sit, enjoy the sculpture, and just rest and get away from things. There's going to be four mounds that surround the sculpture. The proposal is a number of plantings on those slightly elevated mounds. The intent, if one looks at the plantings, is to keep it flowering throughout the growing season. Everything from daffodils to forsythia to lilac to chrysanthemums to roses to bee balm to English daisies to
hydrangeas.
Thank you. Hydrangeas to lupin, to snow mound, spirea, pardon my Latin,
doing pretty well.
And Stella Doro lilies. And these would be slightly elevated and, as I said, would blossom. There's also immediately around the statue would be some geraniums in back of the benches, red, white, and blue, as well as some, a brick patio.
Thank you. Questions, concerns, Counselor Jordan?
No, just my concern. They have been there for years, and the bushes are growing around it, and I've commented about it for years. She's been closed right in, just looks like she's coming out of the woods, as you might say. And I believe there should be a change here. But the way I look at this, it's expanded out so that it's going to be a lot larger than my feeling is it should be, if you're going to do all that and put that all around, and the amount you're going to take from the lawn to do that. That's my concern.
Mr. McGovern, your response?
Yeah, it does expand out, Counselor. Unfortunately, the what you have here, you can't see the maple trees that are on the sketch over there. That they don't show up here because it's just a little, it just takes a snapshot of part of that plan. It's actually, it's just that front portion. It doesn't really take all that much when you look at it. You know, it's a matter of opinion of what is a lot, what isn't. So, but yeah, I had the same concern when I first looked at it. But when I went over in the site and I saw that the scale was 1 inch equals 30 feet, I wasn't as concerned.
Thank you. Councilor Nell?
I was just going to question the scale, and I found it while the manager was speaking, and I was also going to say that Ed has done the landscape. There's a house right next to Plaisted Park, right across from Fort Williams, that he landscaped, and he does a nice job. I guess he's the official landscaper of the 96, I don't know, Olympian, or no, 88 Olympian, 84, I'm sorry, Johnny.
Thank you. Further comment, Councilor Jordan?
I didn't say he didn't do a good job. And I know the gentleman, and I know him real well, and I know what he's capable of doing. It was just throwing out my concerns of the way it would look when you get done. Probably I'm all wet and crazy and what have you, but I still think it's going to expand it out too much.
I would like to make the comment that this is a project being undertaken by, proposed to be undertaken by the Rotary Club, the South Portland Cape Elizabeth Rotary Club, with the total cost of improvements estimated at $4,500 to be totally donated by that club. Any further comments? Can I have a motion on this, please, Councilor Coxell?
I move we accept this very generous donation from the South Portland Cape Elizabeth Rotary Club.
Thank you. We have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? 6-1. Thank you very much. Next on the agenda, we have three items which I imagine most of the people in the audience are here about. We will have a public hearing on these after we have an introductory presentation by members of one or both of the co-chairs of the committee that looked at this. Item number 48 is the Pedals and Pedestrians Committee report, which has been come to known as the P2 Committee. Item number 49 is the proposed Shore Road Bikeway facility, which is referenced in that report. Item number 50 is the proposed Two Lights Road Bikeway facility, which is also referenced in that report. What I would like to do is have, as I said, one or both of the co-chairs of that committee come up to the microphone, give us an overview, introduction, and then I will open the public hearing. After the introduction, I would like to get a show of hands for how many people in the audience would like to address the council on this item this evening. Depending on the number of hands that we see, I may ask that you line up over there. We found, at least last month, that worked much more quickly if people were already in line rather than being called up. And if we get to that point, I'll ask you to try to arrange yourselves pro and con, so we keep it evenly balanced as possible. I'm going to ask speakers to be as brief as possible. You've heard from one counselor tonight. She is not feeling well. We have another counselor here tonight who was not feeling well either. And please try to avoid redundancy. If somebody else two or three people ahead of you in line says, takes the words right out of your mouth, you can get up there and say you concur, or if you want to, you can just go sit down. We've seen you be in line, and we'll know what it means if you sit down. So given all that, I'd like to ask Sarah McCall to come up and give us an introduction, please.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The first time I met you in Cape Elizabeth was when you were the welcome wagon lady, and you've certainly done well for yourself.
Could you explain what the welcome wagon lady is? I'm not.
You know, she never came to your house for a reason.
That was getting in trouble by myself. Yeah.
That wasn't as long ago as many of you have lived in the Cape. I've only been here for 13 years, so I'm definitely from away. And I thought I would just take 30 seconds and tell you who I am with regard to the committee. I am a person that wavered back and forth with regards to a lot of the votes we took on the committee, because at certain points I was convinced that we should do it this way, and then the other way, and then the other way. And perhaps it is because I came from a planning board family in Bar Harbor, and my mother used to come home from these meetings, and she always was telling me the pro and the con of the issues. I tell you that because I want you to know a little bit about how even I thought many of the discussions were, and our process was very tedious. It was not pleasant, but there was no violence. We did have a lot of situations where people were very, very passionate about what we were discussing, but successfully, with the help of all the committee members and Bob Fonts, who I'd like to recognize, who was our consultant for the project, who brought a great deal of knowledge from other places. How had they done things in other places? How could we approach something based on some very objective criteria that had been used and tried and were kind of tried and true? So we dealt with a lot of issues in a very objective way. I will give you two quotes, and this kind of sets up our whole year of work with each other. From William D. Fay, President and CEO of the American Highway Users Alliance, this is questions about ICE-T funding. ICE-T is an acronym for funding that was provided to look at alternate ways of transportation to reduce pollution, to reduce congestion on roads, and therefore perhaps reduce the need for so much paving, so much road space for cars. Quote, the highway funding landscape is obstructed by non-highway diversions, subsidized and poorly patronized mass transit projects, and littered with unaffordable luxuries promoting bicycle riding and historic preservation. God damn it. Okay, from Susan Von Wagner, VP, Snickersville Turnpike Association, Middleburg, Virginia. She was testifying in support of the funds provided through ICE-T, the federal monies for these alternate projects. Transportation is not about vehicles. It's about people. It's about community. On our road, some people do commute to work, but most use the road to travel about the community. People walk and run on the road. They ride bicycles. They even ride horses. Tourists from all over the world travel the road. ICE-T recognizes these differences and makes them all possible. I would suggest to you that those kind of set us up when we went into the process, and as we talked with each other and used these objective criteria, we both could see where both of those people were coming from. With regard to luxuries, unaffordable, we looked at costs. We were horrified. With regard to community and importance, we looked at the importance of getting around and being able to talk to our neighbors, come to some compromises on some key issues because we knew each other and maybe we trusted a little bit each other. But we all saw a bit of importance in that. So just to give you three or four more minutes worth of what we actually did, if you refer to Chapter 6 in your report, that's where the recommendations are. I'm not going to repeat them here because you have them right in front of you and you can refer to them as you need to. Chapter 6 tells you basically what we recommended to the town council. It also talks a lot about three important sections: bike facilities, sidewalks, and greenbelt. And our charge was really to evaluate each kind of facility and then to try to look at them all at once, like a panoramic view, only maybe coming together a little bit and seeming to overlap. That was kind of difficult. But with the help of some very objective criteria, which I'd like to point out, we think we did a pretty good job of it. With regards to bike facilities, what we talked about primarily were bicycle facilities, which is the technical word that is used in this process to define either a bike path or a bike way or a shared lane. And the definitions, if you need them, can be gotten. We use standard definitions. What we boiled it down to is what we felt that a 4-foot wide bicycle path, a shared lane, right, striped so that it's a continuation of the pavement, was what we were talking about when we were talking about safe opportunities for bikers to bike. And we're talking about Class B and C bikers. We're not talking about the Lycra crew that comes through on Saturday mornings. Those are Class A bikers. They're very comfortable on the road. We needed to look at biking from the perspective of people who do need a little bit extra margin of safety because they are younger, they are less experienced, but they are just as committed to biking and perhaps more so in a transportation mode. With regards to bike facilities, we used a criteria where there were 11 criteria where we objectively review all the roads in the Cape, not just Shore Road and not just Two Lights Road, but all the roads in the Cape. And we looked at them and we said, based on these 11 criteria, should we do something to these roads? And those criteria are also listed in your report. With regards to sidewalks, we used an objective set of criteria that are tried and true in other communities that defines, based on whether people are going to certain places and need to walk there, whether there are, help me out with the sidewalk criteria, Bob, if you need to, whether there are existing sidewalks already that should be continued to make certain that people don't come to the end of a sidewalk and need to get someplace. So we use very standard criteria when we evaluated the roads in a defined area of Cape that needed sidewalks. With regards to the Greenbelt, we looked at what had already been done, and we came up with three routes that we wanted to carefully evaluate: an easterly route, a westerly route, and a central route. And those are listed in Chapter 6 under Greenbelt facilities. And we talked a lot about how we could potentially move people from the North Cape down to the town center without perhaps doing it on a conventional way, on a conventional road. We took a lot of field trips. We got involved in a lot of process. And if you'd like to ask us anything about how we did it and how we arrived at something, we're here and we're at your service. Anything real important that I've left out? Thanks very much for your attention and your willingness to give us your comments.
Thank you, sir. Before we proceed, I want to publicly thank the members of the Pedals and Pedestrians Committee. They put in a lot of work, as you can tell if you read the report or even just glance through it and get a little bit into some of the process they went through. I found the report a very good sense of both their accord and the discord during their deliberations. Having been on the appointments committee that helped appoint these folks, I can very much appreciate what we were getting them into, and I think it more than lived up to everybody's expectations. Co-chairs were Bob Bayross and Sarah McCall. The other members were Gary Beckwith, John Hare, Steve Simons, Bob Schumann, Mark Toothaker, Steve Etzel, Jim Bevel, Rosemary Reed, and Irv Chappell. And as Sarah alluded to, Bob Fonts was the consultant selected for the project who worked very closely with the committee. In preparation for tonight's public hearing, the town did send public hearing notices to about 300 residents. These were residents of Shore Road from Plaisted Park to Route 77, all the property owners with frontage on Two Lights Road, property owners with frontage on Scott Dyer Road, frontage owners on Fowler Road from Route 77 to Route 77. I think you know what that means. Ocean House Road from Lyons Field to Mitchell Road, Spurwink Ave from Route 77 to Maxwell's Farm Stand, all of Wells Road, all the properties abutting the Spurwink Marsh from the school complex past Elizabeth Park to Starboard Drive. And there was an additional list supplied by, by Gary Beckwith, whom was included in the mailing. The mailing did announce the public hearing and announce that the committee is making the following recommendations, which I will quickly summarize for you. Town of Cape Elizabeth should not accept the Maine Department of Transportation ICE-T grant and should not build a bikeway on Shore Road to AASHTO, commonly known as ASHTO standards. That was a 6-5 vote. The town of Cape Elizabeth should accept the Maine Department of Transportation grant and should build a bikeway on Two Lights Road to ASHTO standards, ending at the state park entrance. That was an 8-3 vote. A Spurwink River multi-use gravel trail should be constructed to connect the school complex with Starboard Drive, including a spur from the midsection of the trail over to Longfellow Drive. That was a vote, I believe, of 10-1. The town of Cape Elizabeth should build sidewalks as soon as possible on one side of the following roads: Shore Road from Fort Williams Park to Dyer Pond Road, along Scott Dyer Road from Brentwood Road to Spurwink Ave, along Fowler Road, 1,000 feet west of Fenway Road, to Ocean House Road, Old Ocean House Road. Along Ocean House Road from Lyons Field to Mitchell Road, along Spurwink Avenue from Route 77 to Maxwell's Market, and along Wells Road. And finally, the town of Cape Elizabeth should acquire easements to construct multi-use trails that connect various parts of the town with the town center. Priority should be given to an easterly route connecting Fort Williams Park with the town center via Dyer Pond Road. And that was an 8-1 vote from the committee. Given all that, as I mentioned previously, we will hold a public hearing, and if you may address any of the three items: the committee report, the Shore Road Bikeway Facility, the Two Lights Road Bikeway Facility. To start that, I'd like to ask if any councilors have comments or questions before we begin. Councilor Reed?
Madam Chair, I'd just like to correct the list of committee members to include the addition of Mr. Bob Harrison, who succeeded Jim Bevel when Mr. Bevel's term expired on the Conservation Commission, and Mr. Harrison was the Conservation Commission's appointed.
Thank you very much. I didn't have an update on my list.
That was my comment.
That was it? Terrific. Okay. If I could get a showing of hands of people who know they want to speak, people who think they might want to, and people who say, well, I probably won't, but maybe. If you could just raise your hands in case you want to go up to that microphone. Oh boy, they keep sprouting. It's like mushrooms. It's great. All right, I'm seeing probably a good 30 hands. I'm seeing about 50 people in the audience this evening. To facilitate the process this evening, I would like to have you just line up against the wall over there so we'll be able to keep this moving quickly. And again, if we have 30 people, you all want to take 3 minutes, we're looking at an hour and a half, which is fine. That's what we're here for this evening. If you've given us written comments, we have those. All written comments become part of public record. So for the people who did make a specific point of requesting that their comments be read, we are not doing that this evening because they are part of the public record. The council receives copies of all written correspondence. If it comes to town hall, addressed to one councilor, everybody gets it. So to assure those of you who wrote one letter, it does get widely distributed. Mr. Williams, you look like you want to lead the charge.
By default, because I think I'm going to be in the minority.
And I do wish other people, while he is having his brief conversation with us, would line up, please. Would you, when you do come to the microphone, please give us your name and your address.
My name is Neil Williams, 53 Longfellow Drive.
Excuse me. You want to move back with the podium or tilt it a little bit?
I give up.
Turn it towards us.
That's much better. Thank you, sir.
I believe that all of you may have received my letter of June 30th, 1996. I'd like to just express my concern of the lack of publicity, which would be towards the Spurwink multi-purpose trail. And that's what I'm here to address tonight. This would be the one that would run from the high school to Starboard Drive. I would like to thank the town for sending that mailer. When I spoke to people in the neighborhood, no one knew anything about this multi-purpose trail until they received that mailer. So it was very nice of you to send that. Plus, I must add that I was noticing the town agenda, and still it doesn't mention the multi-purpose trail on there. I feel that all the articles that have been in the paper have only been about the bikeways. So I would just like to stress that. I'll cut to the chase and make it quick. I really have no problem with a multi-use trail. However, I would like to keep it natural. Right now, I abut that trailway, and as this weekend, people ride bikes on it. There was horses going down through there. They run on it, and they have no problem at this time. I really don't see what the problem is with this particular area. The only attention that I can see would be maybe down further towards the Starboard Drive area, maybe some extra mowing by Public Works. And that's not a cut to Public Works. I've always already addressed that with Bob Malley, and he knows my concerns about that. But I would have a problem in reading the report if it came to the bituminous pavement service. This, I would like to also say, would also be the most expensive option. This would turn the area into a problem for the properties along this trail. The pavement would be the talk of the town amongst the youth. You would have every type or mode of transportation on demand, which would last all hours of the nighttime. I ask the council, when it comes down to a vote, to consider this an area and leave it just natural, just the way it is. This would also be the less and the least expensive way to the town. It would be good for the town. It would be good for the people that were in that particular area. I might add, though, if some other type of construction in this area is your vote, I would ask you to please take into account drainage in that particular area. I would also ask you to consider placing a fence for the property owners in that area. However, I must restate that I would like to try to keep that area natural. Thank you very much.
Yes, Councilor Nell.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. All right, I understand you don't want pavement. I'm just curious, but how do you feel, how would you feel about, like, gravel, just something to keep, so that it's not, people don't get bogged down in the mud?
If it was gravel, and when we talk gravel, stone, and not necessarily stone dust, which becomes hard, and a wheel type, and I'll be honest with you, I'm concerned more about skateboards, inline skating, that type of, if it wasn't conducive to that, I would be all set with that. But if it was any other type surface, I would kindly request a fence in that particular area with a gate for the property owners to access that area.
And party walls.
Excuse me?
And party walls.
Yes, ma'am.
Could you please give us an idea how many people use that trail as it currently exists on a weekly or monthly basis now?
Depends on the type of the year, time of the year. Cross-country skiing is very populous down there. People cross-country ski that area a lot. Not so many run it. This weekend there was maybe four people on horses that traversed the area. Bicycles go down through there quite a bit. Those modes of transportation are what the P2 committee is all about, and they can do it now. Why do you need to spend any more money on it?
Any other questions from the council? Councilor Reed?
Just for the record, does this go through the area commonly known as Gothrow's Field?
Right through the middle of it.
And would you say that this would allow greater access for those who frequent that spot?
Yeah, to be honest with you, greater access is probably not the term I would use. It would be more easy. Access is access.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Williams.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Susan Berry, and I live at 110 Two Lights Road. Ideologically, my heart is with the goals of the Pedals and Pedestrians Committee. My family once opted to forego having an automobile and traveled only by public transportation, bicycle, or foot for 12 years. Realistically, however, now is not the time, nor is Two Lights Road the place to implement the goals of this committee. I have studied the pedals and pedestrian survey results in detail, and I urge town council members to do the same. And then I have a lot about my methodology that I use to come up with my conclusions, but I won't read it. In a nutshell, 68% of the respondents to the survey think things are fine right now, and 32% see the need for improvement. Of the people who think we need improved bikeways, only 48 chose two lights as a preferred destination. That's 48 people, not 48% of the respondents. Question 1E asks if you would be willing to have your taxes increased to improve bike paths. 400 people, 51%, said no. 287 said under $50 per year, and 93 said over $50 per year. Please read the comments beginning on page 21 of the survey. The respondents state very clearly that bike paths are not a priority right now and that taxes are confiscatory as it is. The Pedals and Pedestrians Committee's May 22nd report contains no cost data for Two Lights Road. What there is pertains to other areas and does not include such costs as acquiring property, moving utility poles, fire hydrants, or water lines. Project cost estimates for paved shoulders are $40 to $50 per linear foot. The portion of Two Lights Road being considered is 5,808 linear feet. At $50 a linear foot, the cost would be $290,400, not including the preceding cost. I read the town's annual report for 1995. In the auditor's report on page 79 and 80, one can see that valuation of property tripled from $216 million in fiscal year 1986 to $648 million in fiscal year 1995. Property taxes more than doubled from $5 million to $11,500,000 during those 10 fiscal years. Between 1986 and 1995, the population grew from 8,244 to 8,854. The bonded debt grew from $665 per person to $1,927 per person in those same 10 years. During the 9 years between 1987 and 1995, the interest on bonded debt has risen from $261,000 paid in 1987 to $913,871 paid in 1995, almost $1 million in interest paid in 1995. Clearly, we should not be getting new discretionary projects until we have the taxes and debt under control. And finally, I have an appeal from the heart. If a bikeway is built on Two Lights Road, the 60-year-old trees bounding our property will be destroyed. We have a sign at the edge of our property that has been there since time began. It says Windy Corners. During the winter, our house is often battered by ocean gales and the stand of trees protects us. I beg you to put aside the idea of a bikeway and let our old growth timber stand instead. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
I hate to be redundant, but my name is Henry Berry. I've been a resident and domiciliary of 110 Two Lights Road in Cape Elizabeth since April 7, 1961. At that time, I purchased the former Hannaford Farm as a home for my family. I've always paid my taxes, I paid the mortgage on the property, and I believe that I had the right to the peaceful enjoyment of the property as long as the taxes were paid. I've looked forward to enjoying the use of my home for whatever time I have left in this world. Suddenly, several months ago, I became aware of a proposal to build bicycle paths for bikers and persons who want to walk on the roads of Cape Elizabeth. I attended a meeting here in this room where the town council appointed a committee to study the shore road and other areas to determine what should be done, if anything. It's my understanding the Department of Transportation has rated the shore road as the only one that is in need of change, according to Councilman Linnell's information, I believe, from the Department of Transportation. I think he's mentioned something along this line in the past. Recently, I've been informed that the committee has recommended not to build bicycle paths along the shore road, which is curvy and heavily traveled, and to descend instead on the Two Lights Road for this perceived problem of safety. The impetus seems to come from persons who are concerned that pedestrians and cyclists will be hit by cars and trucks as they travel along the road. The proposal, I am told, must widen the Two Lights Road by 4 feet on each side in order to obtain federal funds for the project. I strongly submit that the problem of traffic accidents cannot be helped by ruining the character of the Two Lights Road with a widened road, especially on both sides. The needless expansion can only create more traffic at higher rates of speed and higher risk of accident to persons who are on the road. It's a straight road. My own property has been protected from the strong winds coming from the ocean during most of the year by a row of evergreen trees which protect both privacy and abuse from the weather. To take away the front yard of my home and other homes along the Two Lights Road would decimate the properties involved and would serve no valid public purpose, whatever. We who have lived as permanent year-round residents are aware of the severe weather conditions which assault our homes, especially during the 7 months of cold weather when cycling is rarely seen down there. There was one brick home that was so assaulted by the blast of the Atlantic Ocean, which is only 1,000 feet away, that it ate the mortar out from between the bricks and pitted it entirely. You had to have the whole thing right down. We get a lot of weather over there, and these trees and other fences and things protect us from that as well as privacy. To deprive the residents of the Two Lights Road of the continued enjoyment of their home for the sake of a few hours of availability for cyclists is wholly unfair to us who live there 365 days each year and pay taxes for the privilege of owning our property. And here we have seven people who can say you don't own that portion anymore. Your front yard is gone. I served 2 years in the United States Army, 2 terms on the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, and 10 years as district attorney for Cumberland County in order to earn the right as an American to spend my declining years in peace. Any existing problem of speeding motorists can be quickly solved in the same way that our neighbors in Scarborough have solved theirs at Black Point. Many of you have been over there. If motorists are causing a risk of hazard, then their wrongdoing should not and cannot be solved by making white lines on the roadside. A cruiser with a radar unit can send a clear message faster and more effectively than any plan of the few to take away the enjoyment of homeowners' property at huge and unwarranted public expense. They've upped the fines down here in the district court. You can't get out of there for much less than $100 on the lowest fines lately. Also, a few road signs would indeed help. A few road signs that said bikers, cyclists, pedestrians, children, slow. That might help to alert the motorists who are coming along. But that's a dead-end road down there. It doesn't go anywhere. I implore you to cast a negative vote on any proposal to alter the present layout of the Two Lights Road. The proposal is not heavily supported by those of us whose homes will be affected. And the residents of this quiet neighborhood should be allowed the peaceful enjoyment of their homes without interference from those who may mean well, but who misperceive the effectiveness of the awful punishing treatment they propose for the rest of us. I enclose a list with the document that I've submitted to the council with only a few of the problems which would be created by the Two Lights Road proposal, among those being moving hydrants, moving utility poles, and taking people's front yards when they've tried to improve their property and make an attractive neighborhood. And it would be a bad move for most of the residents agree that it would be a bad move to put 4 feet on either side of the Two Lights Road just up to the state park. Also, that non-conforming use down at the, a couple of non-conforming uses down at the end by the lighthouse create a lot of traffic that increased the problem and if that were enforced, but that's in your notes so you can read that. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Berry.
Good evening. My name is Thomas Egan. I live at 41 Hannaford Cove Road. It's a hard act to follow, Henry. I'm Henry's neighbor on Hannaford Cove Road. My wife and I have 3 children, each of whom would love to ride their bike to Pond Cove School or the middle school or the high school, ultimately. In fact, this spring, my son, who is 11, set out on his first journeys by bike to the middle school, and my wife and I held our breath as we could imagine him riding his bike down Two Lights Road. And so there's one side of this equation that I feel militates in favor of accepting the recommendation of the committee, namely safety. And yet the other side of the equation is so potentially onerous, I believe, to the neighborhood and to those whose houses border on Two Lights Road, in many cases very closely, that I cannot support the recommendation of the committee. Instead, I believe that it would be appropriate for the council to go back to the committee and ask them if they could show in graphic terms how substantial the impact would be visually, quality of life-wise, but most important, in terms of courses and distances, how bad that impact would be on the houses on Two Lights Road, such as the Griffins or Mrs. Jordan or the Sullivans, whose houses are very, very close to the roadway, as you can see. And that would be, that is my request, A, that you deny, I'm sorry, that you vote against the recommendation, but that you do so with a request for additional study of the impact that the expansion of the roadway would have on the neighbors. And I think that request to the committee could be couched in terms of asking whether there could be some deviation from the AHSHTO standards, these federal standards, so that instead of this behemoth highway, this massive wide throughway, if you will, coming down our neighborhood, having bike paths on both sides, that there might be some consideration of something less than that, that would have less impact on the neighbors. And I'll close by noting that I bought a pair of rollerblades the other day, and at age 45, I found myself at 6:30 in the morning rollerblading down Two Lights Road toward Route 77, and I said to myself, this is pretty scary, as the cars were approaching me. But I took that risk knowingly. And I would only do it in the instances where during the day I felt that the traffic wasn't bad, which in the summertime on Two Lights Road is pretty much limited to the early morning, because the traffic coming down Two Lights Road in the summertime is very heavy. In particular, heavy because of the draw of clients to the Lobster Shack. So, whereas I would like my kids to be perfectly safe, I don't think this is a perfectly safe world. There may be some way to increase the element of safety for them, and I would appreciate that consideration very much. But I think tonight, I don't believe you have enough information before you to make an intelligent and informed decision. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr.
Good evening. My name is Bob Schumann. I live in Delano Park, 16 Delano Park. Beginning with a public testimony at the council meeting about 19 months ago in January 1995, it became evident that this town is divided on the issue of widening the roads for bicycle paths. This has been reinforced by the 4-3 vote of the council that night and by repeated votes of the P2 committee. I am confident that tonight's speakers will only underline that fact that we do have a deadlock. Neither side on this issue is suddenly going to make converts of their opposition, and neither is going to reveal to you a hidden majority to sweep you off your feet. Given this condition of two sides, each locked in and unchanging, I respectfully suggest that this is not the time to make a change in the character and the ambiance of the roads on the Cape. If not making a change proves later to be a mistake, then the future will provide time to rectify that mistake. If making a change prematurely proves in the future to have been an error, then that kind of mistake cannot be set right. Once the lichen-covered stone walls are torn down and the large old trees removed, the character of these roads changed forever. No amount of regret or effort can ever restore what is gone. Let's let it cool for a while and let time work its magic. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Schumann.
Hello, my name is Tom Allen, not to be confused with the aspiring politician. I live at 47 Longfellow Drive, and Neil has pretty much said what I wanted to say, but I still have a couple other things I'd like to add to that. I recently bought the home from my parents and have lived there 26 of my 32 years. The trail that's there now, that there, the Spurwink multi-use trail is proposed, the trail's been there for years. I used it as a kid. We biked up and down it. It was a great way to get to school. It was a safe way to get to school. And I understand the need to possibly put this as a connector for new homes going in on the other end of Cape. But my concern is that a paved roadway or a paved path through there is going to, again, increase traffic. It's going to increase problems. There's a lot of partying that goes on with kids up in that area. I mean, keeps people up all hours of the night at certain weekends. That's just going to invite it even more. I have a 2-year-old daughter, 6-year-old son, who play out in that area because it directly abuts my property. In fact, I mow past it just for convenience, even though it's not my land. And they play out there, and I'm concerned that with a lot of speeding bikes on a pavement surface, that there's going to be potential for some injury. Crushed gravel I don't think would work well. I mean, from what I know about biking, the biking I do is better on a hard packed surface that's there now than on crushed gravel. I just don't know that I see the need to spend the money to improve something that's already there just for looks, the only reason I can see. Also, and just in closing, because I'd like to be brief, as a new property owner in Cape, that's seen quite a tax increase in my few years that I've been here. I'm seeing a whole lot of proposed spending going on, and it makes me kind of nervous. That'll be it.
Thank you, Mr. Allen.
Carol Fritz, Hunt Club Road. I generally agree with the final recommendations of the P2 committee, the vote they made on the 22nd of May. I think the bike path extension at Two Lights Road is a pretty good idea, although I certainly question the federal standards of 4 feet on both sides. I don't really think that's necessary. I do ride a bike on that road, and I don't have any trouble with the width now, but I think we could do with 2 feet on each side. I do think it is an interesting and scenic extension from the existing bike path to Two Lights Road, or Two Lights State Park. I agree with the committee's conclusion that Ocean House Road to Kettle Cove did not need to be widened, both because there really isn't that much traffic, and I would hate to see great impact on the front yards that are very close there. I don't think Fezzeden Road needed to be improved beyond the repaving that's been done recently, so I think that makes a nice connecting route there. I favor the multi-use trail behind Elizabeth Park, although I certainly sympathize with the closeness of that neighborhood and their backyard, so I would urge that it be minimized as much as possible. I think that the first three suggestions for sidewalks that are near neighborhoods, the Shore Road, small section, Scott Dyer, and Fowler Road, make some sense. I do question the sections that are listed in for improvement on the sidewalks on Ocean House Road because we already have a bike path there. I used to own a piece of property at 21 Ocean House and know that that road is very, very close. And I don't think a sidewalk needs to take any more from those yards. Spurwink and Wells don't seem to need any improvement as far as I'm concerned in sidewalks. Shore Road was a close vote with the committee, and I'm very much opposed to widening Shore Road for a bike path. I think it would destroy the appearance of a road that people in Cape Elizabeth rank as the most scenic road in the town. But even more important, I think that widening the road with a bike path that abuts the traveled way for cars, and if we invite bikers to come and more walkers and joggers to come, it will be a more dangerous road than it is now. Because I believe that when you see a visually straighter, wider road, drivers of cars unconsciously go faster. I think one of the biggest problems I see as a bike rider out on the roads now is the condition of the pavement as it is on the road. Particular example that the worst road I've run into is Old Ocean House Road, which has cracks in the pavement running parallel to the paved way that bikes, particularly like mine, which is a road bike with narrow tires, can easily get trapped into, and the bike be flipped right over. If you're riding a bike, you have to move yourself into the middle of the paved way when you come to one of those conditions, and a driver behind you is not likely to know what you're trying to avoid and not expect you to come out there. So I think that kind of situation is the most dangerous we have in the town right now for bikers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Fritz.
I'm Nancy Sears, 17 Linwood Street. I do not live near any of these proposed paths. I would like to just say that I am very much against any bike path being put on Shore Road. It's a beautiful road as it is. It is narrow. It is dangerous. And I would hate to see a bike path being cut into anybody's property along Shore Road. When I first heard about this, my thought was, why not a good bike trail all the way from the bridge out 77 to Crescent Beach State Park? I would like people in Portland to be able to ride their bikes out to that beautiful beach. I think South Portland and Cape Elizabeth might cooperate on such a path. I would like it to end at Crescent Beach State Park. And my last comment is, I wonder if municipalities ever say to the federal government, thank you very much, but we don't need this money. Use it for something else.
Thank you, Ms. Sears.
I'm Ann Van Lonkhuizen on Shore Road. I concur with the P2 committee regarding not putting a bikeway on Shore Road for all the reasons they give. I don't think it would make it safer by widening it, having one. If you really want to make it safer, you can prohibit commercial traffic from using the road unless they have local deliveries there. I'd also like to ask you where you plan to put the sidewalk that's supposed to go from Fort Williams to Dyer Pond Road. Will it come out at the south end near the Irving south end of the fort and then go to Dyer Pond, or what did you have in mind?
We'll get an answer for that at the end of the time.
And there again, I think it might be a good idea to not widen the road, because I think all they will do is flip over faster than ever, as they do now, over the brow of the hill, and I think it will just make it more dangerous than it is now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Lonkhuizen.
Ruth Pitsley, 24 Old Fort Road. Cape Elizabeth is unique. It's unique because it's been wonderfully endowed by nature, because although only 10 or 15 minutes from the largest city in the state, it has maintained a rural atmosphere. And because generations of citizens have had the good sense not to fix what doesn't need fixing, now all is threatened. If we deface Shore Road, it won't be safer, and it will destroy forever part of what makes Cape Elizabeth unique. You have the power. Right now, you are a unique group. You have the power to do just that. But power in the absence of wisdom is a destructive force. Some members of the Advisory Commission and the Planning Board have voiced a reluctance to put time constraints on any projects because they don't know what the future holds. The future will take the shape that you have the courage to give it. And I hope you will consider all the changes that you're faced with and do what's right, not for the now, but for the generations to come.
Thank you, Ms. Pitsley.
My name's Steve Barber. I live right next to the state park on Sunnybank Road, and I'm in favor of the bike path on Two Lights Road. And actually, it just came to me this Sunday as I was driving up towards Cape Shore Variety now for the paper. My neighbors, who have a young family also, had their three kids on bicycles. It was probably around 10 o'clock in the morning, and there were just cars on either side of the road. The cars were not going fast, but I was in fear that one of those kids was going to get hit. And again, nobody was driving fast. This was not on a turny section of the road. This was right by the strawberry fields. And, you know, from my viewpoint, something needs to be done. The town's got an opportunity. I understand the concerns of the people that live right on the road. If there's something that can be done in compromise with them, I think that'd be great, but that road is just not safe. With the state park, along with other business on the road, there's just a tremendous amount of traffic. And again, from not this hearing, the previous hearing, I've heard that don't worry about Two Lights Road, it's a straight shot. This was right on the, right next to the strawberry fields, and this was this Sunday. So again, people can say that there's not a concern, that there is. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Braddock.
Alice Rand, 1222 Shore Road. That address is important. I do not live by the road. I live on the road. I am intimately acquainted with that section of Shore Road, since our bedroom is only 50 feet from the edge of the road. And my desk offers a front row seat of pedestrians, joggers, cyclists, and what the road was originally intended for, motorized vehicular traffic. I have a brother-in-law who has a macabre sense of humor, and when he was sometimes annoyed with the antics of his two sons, he'd say, "Why don't you go out and play on the white line in the middle of the road?" Roads were never meant to be playgrounds or recreational space. Are we seriously considering putting a bike path on a scenic, historic, curvy, narrow road, using yours and my tax dollars on a scenic road, and using these tax dollars at both the local and federal level, an act that would devalue many properties and change forever the character of the road? Shore Road is a road that has been designated as scenic by both the visual assessment study done by Holly Dominey, a state advisor, and by ZORC, the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee. Surely there are better ways to expend these federal ICE-T funds in more user-friendly environments. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Rand.
My name is Peggy Farnsworth, and I live at 211 Two Lights Road. I would not be affected.
Excuse me, you can move that microphone down. It bends. Okay. It makes it easier.
Thanks. I wouldn't be affected myself by this bicycle path, but I am very much opposed to it. I think Two Lights Road is a beautiful road now. I think it would take property from neighbors that have been there for years, and I'll make it very short. I'm just very opposed to it.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Farnsworth.
My name's Wayne Brooking. I live on the end of Two Lights Road, and I'll make it even shorter. I'm just opposed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brooking.
My name is Richard Mahoney. I live at 27 Fowler Road. I'm addressing the issue of the pedestrian and bike pathway on Shore Road. I'm opposed for the following reason. I'd like to graphically show you on this board. This paper is approximately 11 inches. This is approximately 4 feet, the width of each pathway. This is approximately 2 feet. If you were riding a bicycle on this side, you'd easily take up this much room. A bicycle must ride with traffic. Bicyclists go 15 miles an hour. A pedestrian, a grandfather, a mother, a child, would be on this side, and they'd be walking against the traffic. They'd be at least, at some point on a Saturday or Sunday, a bicyclist going this way, and a grandmother, a grandfather, a child walking this way. There'd also be a jogger and a runner. And we all know runners go faster than joggers. Which way would they be going? Take a guess. You don't know, do you? Probably against the traffic. So they're running behind the grandfather walking his daughter or granddaughter. And now you have set up a double highway of 4 feet on each side. I'm going to drop this thing here. You've set up essentially two additional highways, if you will, in quotes, on the side of a dual road that allows 35 mile an hour traffic. I am against carnage in Cape Elizabeth. And I'm sure everyone here is, and everyone on this panel is. Consider it. The first death that occurs will end this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mahoney.
My name is Mary McDonough, and I'm a new resident on Shore Road, 1107. It happens to be the most magnificent view on that road, and therefore I am totally opposed to any widening of the road as it would be set up as a tourist trap 100%. Right now, we're inundated with all sorts of stopper buyers, viewers, parking the driveway, whatever, and we are inundated with commercial traffic going by at 50 miles an hour. That has got to stop in order to be able to remain as a resident on Shore Road. And as far as the safety for others, I'm totally opposed to any bike route on that road. Leave it to the beauty that it is.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. McKenna.
Joanne Schnell, 214 Spurwink Avenue. I think 4 feet is way too much. I would be in heaven if I had a 2 foot shoulder to ride, especially on Spurwink Avenue. And the part where I live on Spurwink is not even included in the plan. I'd also like to say that I think that some of the side roads, Eastman Road, Wells Road, Fessenden Road, don't need any widening. And I think that sidewalks in some of these on the part on Spurwink Avenue and on Wells Road are somewhat redundant. Thank you.
Thank you, Schnell.
Mark Woodward, 96 Wells Road. After a long search, I finally found the property that I think I'm going to really enjoy a lot. One of the issues, I think, in increasing the width of the road is a question of scale. And one of the things that we keep coming back to is how beautiful it is, what a nice rural character it has, what an ambiance it has. And I think that the concept of just increasing the amount of pavement is sort of contrary to what everybody is out there trying to enjoy. And for my part, Wells Road, I've been watching it quite a bit lately, and I ride my bicycle there a lot. It does not seem to get the amount of traffic that really warrants want a sidewalk or two, a wider bicycle path. I think they're perfectly adequate the way they are. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Woodward. I'm just going to ask for a quick cap here. Is there anybody else who's not up in line who is interested in joining the line? If you could I'm just trying to get a count sense here. Thank you.
Howard Littlefield, 6 Lawson Road. Lawson, I live right on the corner of Shaw Road and Lawson Road, and I see every so all the time in my travels, when you drive Shaw Road, if there's a bike going up Shaw Road, and a car's coming around the corner, the car goes way out over the yellow line, and coming the other way the same way. Someday someone's going to meet. 2 feet is not too much. 2 feet is there already in most cases where the mail truck pulls off. A lot of it is just unkept. If you pave that, you still have the room for the plows to plow. Most of the time in the wintertime, they plow that 2 feet anyway and push the snow back. That 2 feet is already there. 2 feet on each side. If you go out in Scarborough, Black Point to Prout's Neck, I work in Scarborough, by the way, that's 2 feet on each side. From Higgins Beach to Black Point Road, the state was going to put 4 feet in, and they ended up only putting 2 feet in, but that's plenty of room. I would go, you need something on Shore Road. There's 23 kids in my neighborhood, and there's more in Beach Bluff and the other neighborhoods down the way. And now's the future. Now's the time to add the 2 feet. I don't care if it's some cases if you pave it right away, but at least add the 2 feet of dirt or something so there is a shoulder there. But I think the way to go is on all these roads is as the town upgrades the road, 2 feet should be added on all these roads that are major roads in the town. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Littlefield.
Good evening. I live on Smuggler's Cove Road, and my name is Peter Rich, and I'm here not part of the majority tonight, but Sarah indicated at the start that there were people for and against the proposals as indicated by her opening references to the two folks who she quoted. I believe that Shore Road ought to be upgraded to have a bicycle and a walking path on either side, and I say that as one that likes to walk Shore Road and that one that bikes Shore Road. I bike Shore Road not primarily as recreation, but as transportation to get from one place to another without using my car. I believe that is environmentally sound. I think it is a small contribution that I might make to my environment. I think it improves the whole atmosphere of a community if people get to places by means other than the automobile. Shore Road was not created for the car. Shore Road was created long before the advent of the car, when people walked or went by horseback. And as to this demonstration here on the board, I would tell you that I would covet a place that I could walk safely on Shore Road in the evening time or in the time when I have off, that I would not be ducking constantly into the bushes when a car would come by. And that is a nice space to be in. I think the things you've heard before about the advisability of Shore Road as a bikeway, I need say no more, but I do wish you would give serious thought of it not only as a place of recreation, but as a form of encouragement to people to use other means of transportation than the car. Maybe not all the time, but a substantial part of the time for doing local errands. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rich.
My name's Richard Blake. I live on Ivy Road, Cape Elizabeth. I'm here representing the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. I'm president of the Land Trust, and we are not taking a position on any of the issues being discussed tonight. However, we are an owner of some land that I think the proposed path from the high school to Starboard Road traverses, and we were not appraised of that trail going in before today. It's the first time I heard about it. We would like to be a party to any discussions regarding that trail, particularly how it affects our land, access over it. And I would probably preference those comments by saying also that we would prefer not to see any pavement ever laid on that land. So if there's any discussions, we would like to be party to those as this trail discussion keeps going.
You will be. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Bob Harrison. I live on 42 Highview Road, and as Rosemary so graciously noted, I'm the add-in member of the P2 committee. The council has received and is has introduced into the record a minority opinion letter, one page, that will be available to the public. It's addressed to the members of the town council, and it is co-signed Gary Beckwith, myself, Sarah McCall, and Steve Simons. And I want to make a couple of points regarding that letter to the town council and to the citizens present, people who have spoken already. Primary task of this letter, I think, was to address the possibility of work on Shore Road that was not necessarily intrusive or destructive of the scenic beauty. There are several things that I think we would all agree on. One is that there is a potential safety problem on Shore Road especially. I will spend all of my time on Shore Road because I think that's where the major problem is. The points that I want to make about the P2 decision or the recommendation regarding Shore Road are fairly straightforward. First, the vote was 6-5 in favor. That's actually a very close vote. One swing would have given the town council a recommendation to accept the grant. It should be noted that all of the people who voted of the active cyclists, the most active cyclists on the committee, all voted in favor of acceptance. I believe that the four people signing this letter represent the most active cycling component within the P2 committee, and we feel very strongly about Shore Road, primarily because of our personal experiences with poor safety on the road. A little anecdote from my own past. When I moved here 6 years ago, one of the foolish things that I did was to put my kids in my bike trailer and go to Family Fun Day the first time I had the opportunity. That was the last time that my kids had been on Shore Road on bicycle, and the simple reason is because of safety. I would point out to everyone that regarding Shore Road, the committee's final report offers no actual solution. The letter, which I've indicated is in the public record, points out three examples of negotiated solutions, one of them in this town, the north end of 77, apparently, before I moved here in the early 1980s. There was a significant amount of negotiation regarding MDOT standards, and apparently there was a negotiated solution that was arrived at that provided the safety and other improvements without significantly affecting the existing features. Additionally, there's currently work in Falmouth on Route 88 and in Scarborough on Route 207. And in both situations, according to Gary Beckwith and I believe Steve Simons, who may have some comments on that following me, there has been a significant process engaged with MDOT for negotiation of waivers in terms of placement and width of shoulders for the bikeways in order to minimize the impacts on the existing features. The final comment that I have regarding this is summarized in the final paragraph of this letter, and I'd like to read a couple of sentences. It seems clear that the core of the Shore Road issue is not an aversion to bicycle and pedestrian use, but rather the desire to preserve property and scenic beauty. Acceptance of the grant with adequate negotiation for width and placement waivers could create a win-win situation, preserving Shore Road's scenic beauty while enhancing bicyclist and pedestrian safety. I have one other point to make, and that is in reference to the committee's final report. I will read from two sentences from page 6.3. Note beforehand that a number of other people have indicated that the quality of the road's shoulders, the quality of the road's surface, for example, Carol Fritz's comment about Old Ocean House, which I ride routinely, is very appropriate. And in light of that, we made a recommendation that is buried within the final P2 report that I'd like to add to the record. Committee recommends that all other roads in Cape Elizabeth receive, quote, adequate shoulder maintenance, unquote, which is defined as maintaining the entire length of road shoulder as wide as the widest existing section of road shoulder and ensuring that it is kept swept and free of debris beyond the white side pavement line. And I made a significant point of this, and I believe I got agreement on both sides of the P2 committee that if there were simply a commitment on the part of the town to consistently maintain the quality in terms of width and pavement quality of the shoulders on roads such as Old Ocean House or even Shore Road, that many of the problems and the contentiousness of this issue would probably be greatly mitigated. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harrison.
My name is Dexter Hunterman, and I live at 1218 Shore Road. I've lived there for 46 years. And I love Shore Road. I think it's the most beautiful road, without any question, in the town of Cape Elizabeth. And I've traveled all over the state of Maine, and I have yet to see a more beautiful road anywhere in the state of Maine than there is right here. I've written you all, and I hope you've had the opportunity to read my letter, and I would like to emphasize one point that's in that letter that has not been made. An awful lot of good points have been made tonight. And that point is that widening Shore Road and tearing down lots of beautiful stone walls and cutting down lots of beautiful trees and taking a lot of people's front lawns away is going to be just for the benefit of a very small minority of people. Everybody in the world doesn't ride bicycles. There are only a few people who ride bicycles. Most of us people just walk, or we ride in a car or something like that. So I do hope that you ladies and gentlemen will keep that in mind when you come to your vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hunterman.
Madam Chair, members of the council, my name is Steve Simons. I live at 18 Brentwood Road. And I was a member, am a member of the, was a member of the P2 committee. And I might say at the outset that that was a very pleasant, productive experience for me. There was a note earlier made to the fact that there was dissension and diversity. Actually, there was a tremendous amount of consensus among us all. That, I think, made for a sound report to you. There was, however, one item I'd like to speak to briefly, namely safety on Shore Road, which some of us are still very concerned about. In fact, it concerned all of us on the committee that there was a problem of safety on Shore Road, evidenced by the ratings that we gave it. Problem was, we offered no solutions. We made no recommendations to address that issue. We left it hanging. And in our opinion, we have had opportunity, I think, to go further, to discuss possible alternatives. It may not have been in our province to negotiate directly with MDOT on what they would accept for standards. And most of us clearly were not happy with the ASHTU standards as they were first presented to us. But we've all learned and heard that negotiations are possible. In fact, the informal grapevine suggests that MDOT would be willing to consider negotiating. And since this problem won't go away, It will become more intense. There will be more traffic. There will be more bikers. There will be more pedestrians. It is a beautiful road, and it will attract people in all forms. And so I would urge the council to initiate negotiations with MDOT to consider what are the minimum requirements to mitigate this problem of safety on Shore Road, and see if they can participate in financing according to your specifications and your minimum requirements, fine. If not, I still think something does have to be done, not only from the standpoint of safety, but we also heard from experts that this is a way to save money in the long run, that it reduces cost of maintenance considerably when you have some further shouldering on the road. And it doesn't have to be a lot of shouldering. As others have pointed out, some of us would be very happy with just a couple more feet. I went down Shore Road again today, as I've had done so many times, to see what have I missed. I mean, what can be done without destroying the beauty of that road? And none of us want to impinge on the visual assets, the landscaping, and the pleasure that one has going up and down Shore Road. We wouldn't accept standards, any kind of standards, that would do that. But there are ways of making it that road safer. And as I looked at it today, just paving the amount of gravel that is there and available for paving without moving anything to speak of would make a tremendous difference in terms of safety. So I'd urge the council not to drop the issue here, but to take it further and initiate those discussions with MDOT. It would be give those of us who are still an active member of the biking community, my wife and I, and many others, some assurance that we weren't neglecting safety. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Simon.
I'm Frank Potenzo, 8 Ivy Road. I've lived in the Cape for 38 years now. And it seems to me we're going around in circles a little bit. I concur with all the citizens here that wish to keep Shore Road the way it is, keep Two Lights Road the way it is. It seems to me that we have federal grant money that's burning a hole in our pockets. We wish to use it. And maybe it can find some other ways to utilize it. But remember, federal grant money is only good for a one-time shot. If anything is done with that money to put bike paths or sidewalks or whatever, that after a few years, the money's gone, and then the maintenance costs are borne by the town and the taxpayers. I attended two or three meetings of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee, and it was voted in favor not to do anything on Shore Road. Right after that vote, a motion was made to the effect that couldn't something be done on Shore Road? And that was shot down. This meeting that was held on May 22nd in favor of bicycle path on Shore Road, and then on May 31st, on this single page that was inserted, that the motion in favor of doing anything Shore Road failed. The motion was defeated. And the motion was also defeated to improve shoulders on Shore Road. One last thing, if no bike path is going to go on Shore Road, and everyone here, most people have said to the effect that it would destroy the rural character of Shore Road, the beauty of it, I don't believe that sidewalks should be added to Shore Road, even if it's a couple of hundred yards of sidewalk. because that could lead to a dangerous usage by skateboarders, bikers, roller skaters, rollerblade people. And I don't know how many have had the occasion on Shore Road of going around a curve, many curves on Shore, going around, and all of a sudden there are five bikers bunched up, not single file, but bunched up. And you have to slow down, and they're not going at a steady speed, they're all kind of wobbling, talking to each other in a group. And if there are cars coming in the opposite direction, you almost have to stop in order to get by. If you toot the horn, you get, I'm going to say it, from a minority group, you get glaring looks as if to say, what are you doing on this road with your car? Now, it's probably unrealistic, but there are some people that might say, why don't we shut down Shore Road from automobile transportation? Let's have it for people to walk on, to bike on, to run on, and route all the traffic coming from South Portland into Cape onto Mitchell Road and Route 77. Now that is most unrealistic, but some people, I mean, everyone in Cape has one car, two or three, and they're all in love with their cars. And I think there are more people who own cars than there are bikes. So I would say to the council, accept the report that Pedals and Pedestrian Committee gave you that there would not be any bikeways on Shore Road, and nothing would be done on Shore Road. I'm in favor of nothing being done on Two Lights Road either. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Potenza.
My name is Marion Guthrie. I live at 8 Delano Park. I've been there for 21 years. I thought I was going to be the last. It's always nice to be a participant in democracy and action in Cape Elizabeth. It brings excitement to everyone's lives. I have listened very carefully tonight. I have been opposed to the bike paths on both of the roads.
Marion, can you step back a bit?
Oh, sure. Can you hear me?
Yep.
I have been opposed to the bike paths. I listened with an open mind tonight. I remain opposed to the bikeways. I do not believe that one nickel should be spent on projects of this nature when there are so many other more pressing priorities which need to be addressed in our town. For example, our most critical resources, our own police and fire departments who deal with safety for all of us, are crammed into almost unworkable tight quarters. Shouldn't that situation be addressed before we discuss building bikeways? Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Guthrie.
My name's Kimberly Moody, and I live at 22 Lawson Road, a relatively newcomer to Cape Elizabeth, although hope to be a long liver here. And I am in favor of bike paths and sidewalks, and I think that we couldn't put our money in any better spot than to provide safety and transportation means by legs or by bikes for our children. And I know I'm coming from another generation than many of those who spoke against the bike paths and who feel that there is a minority who are biking and walking. But you just have to come to my neighborhood and see the children biking around who would love to be able to walk or bike to school. But it's unsafe. And what we're talking about is safety. Do we want to put our money in a means that will provide safety for our children? They're going on Shore Road anyway. And even when their parents are saying, oh, you know, it's very dangerous there, you'll see them head out there because it's part of their street. They want to go visit their friends. They want to walk up to visit their friends who are off from Shore Road, from one neighborhood to the other. It's happening now, and having been a runner on Shore Road almost every day, I've had many close calls. I've also traveled by car and had some close calls almost hitting runners or bikers. The bikers and runners are not going to go away, and the children don't go away. And I just want to plead with you to put our money in the children's safety. I also think it's ecologically sound. How many cars? Oh, they can take the bus. However, there's after-school programs or there are sports programs up and down with children who are less than a mile away from their school. They could be riding their bikes. They could be walking. So I guess I think it's prudent in the long term to put our money towards safety.
Thank you, Mrs. Moody. Is there anybody else who would like to address the council in this public hearing? No. All right, seeing none, I will close the public the words just close the public hearing for this evening.
Thank you.
There have been questions if we would take public comment at next month's meeting, presuming that there will be a vote next month rather than this evening. At that time, if there is new information or if people want to encapsulate in 5 minutes for pro or con, I will entertain that, but we will not have a protracted public hearing again next month. We've had them in the past, and we've had them this evening. Mrs. McCall?
There were two questions.
Would you come to the microphone, please? I thank you for addressing factual information for us.
There were just two questions that were kind of posed to the council that I thought that I would answer. One was, where would the sidewalk be placed from Fort Williams to Dyer Pond Road? And we were talking about placing it on the Fort Williams side, which would be so that you could come out of the park at the southerly end and use it to go down to Dyer Pond Road. The other question was, or comment, was that there were no cost estimates with regards to two lights. There were in our report, and that was a point well taken, and I appreciate that it was brought up, because the two pieces of information with regards to costs, one for two lights and the other for Shore Road, were contained in earlier documents, which were actually, there's an addendum that was placed in the report that called attention to that. So that you don't leave thinking that we did not look at the costs for two lights and Shore Road. We did. We evaluated them, and those documents are available if you need to have them. They were prior cost estimates and very, very, very specific cost estimates done on removing this tree and going over this wetland, etc. So just to clarify those two points. You know, I don't know where that is. I apologize. Bob, do you have that?
Do you mean tennis use the present gate if you go into the tennis field and stand there down past the
river?
We're having a problem with everybody being able to hear this conversation, and I think if you want to make a comment, you can come to the microphone, please. We're not going to have a protracted conversation at this time because public hearing has been closed. We'll take a quick recommendation, and that's something the council can consider at its workshop.
I would recommend that you'd come out at where the gate is at the Irvins.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't, I would recommend that you put the sidewalk inside the fort along the wall there or wherever you want to put it, because that would obviate your widening Shore Road and thus making it more dangerous, because cars tend to speed there and they would speed even more.
Thank you very much.
Well,
I believe we have a question from the council for Mrs. McCall, if you'd come back, please.
From me.
Oh, thanks.
There were just some comments made here tonight that we will be taking this to workshop and voting next month. However, we won't have this audience to clarify some of the misconceptions that were presented, specific to the recommendations that we made and the votes that were taken in the May meeting that Mr. Potenzo commented on, so that people don't think we took votes and didn't record them or include them. My recollection of that second motion, which I probably made, was not considered because two members were not present, and those two members had sent in their votes by proxy. And the determination was made not to take a vote because all 11 were not present. So therefore, there was no motion that was seconded, and there was no vote. Is that correct?
Yes, but I'm not sure they all got that.
We didn't have a vote. That's why it wasn't recorded. There was no omission, and I just wanted to make that clear.
Okay.
The other thing is regarding the comments regarding other projects, specifically drainage and Running Tide Road specifically. No, Tide's Edge Road.
Tide's
sorry,
Edge.
Wrong neighborhood.
Yep.
We did include the discussion of the synergistic effect of using projects, I'm sorry, I'm
project funds.
Project funds that will have to be paid with local dollars, dollar for dollar, over the next 5 years, and having them incorporated in with other projects. So for those people who think that we look at this in an isolated situation, I wanted your minds relieved. And I've heard repeatedly about the taking of property, the moving of trees, stone walls, etc. In light of the fact that Shore Road has a 50 at its narrowest and 80 at its largest right-of-way, and that only 26 to 28 feet of Shore Road and that right-of-way is currently used as a road, I just am very concerned that people think that taking of property is needed for this project. And as Mr. Littlefield has pointed out, the most of the area that would be needed to complete this project, or a lot of this area, is currently being used, but not as a specified bikeway. And I just wanted to make sure that that was a fair statement, and that is the findings that we found. Then the last thing, we have a written letter from MDOT. We have comments from MDOT saying that this is a local project, although backed with federal money at an 80-20 ratio, but that we would control and have comments into the process. And I just wanted to make sure, although in my packet it's in writing from the MDOT with the letterhead, but I just think that the people ought to know that we already have assurances that we can work with and negotiate this, and that the council, in their last 4-3 vote on this subject, they have a recommendation, I can't remember the number, that says that a 7-member committee would be formed to work with the design. So we did not get into the design aspects of that. And is that all
yep,
correct?
That's accurate. In fact, reflective of so many people's request that we not do the 4-foot wide on both sides, we were constrained because that's the ICE-T requirement, but we kept asking each other if we couldn't negotiate with MDOT to decrease that in certain places so that for aesthetics or environmental concerns, we would not be disruptive. That's accurate.
And to those people who think this is a new idea, would you confirm that this process began in 1984? And also, the letter that was written by the minority, although I was in the minority, I did not author or pen in any way the words on that minority report because I would be a counselor acting on it. But I do want you to know I do support what you said in that report. And then my final thing, there are 400 signatures on petitions that Rosemary Reed presented to the town council. Prior to my becoming a member of the town council, of people who supported the Shore Road bikeway, many of whom asked me over the past several weeks if their name was already on record and if in fact those petitions were part of the public record, and that would their comments be recognized. And I assured them that is correct. I'd like a confirmation that those petition signatures are...
Anything that passes to the council will be in the file.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Are there any other questions or comments directed from the council to Mrs. McCall? Councilor Linnell?
Well, Mrs. McCall doesn't need to respond. You can sit down, actually. I just would like to make a couple comments, because Mr. Berry, one thing he referred to was, and what I talked about with him, he stopped by the house and took me for a ride down Two Lights Road yesterday. And one thing I mentioned to him, and I know some people, many people in this room perhaps have heard this, is the critical rate factor. And the Department of Transportation has a formula by which they rate the relative safety of roads in this town. And that's how they determine. They base it on accidents and so forth. And I don't know how they come up with their formula, but there's one road in this town which is at the one-point level, which is at the point when they start thinking about, well, maybe we should put in a stop sign or widen the road or narrow the road or put in a light, traffic light or anything. And that stretch of road is on Shore Road, so I hope that at some point we do something about that. And that's the reference that Mr. Berry made. We have, and I reviewed it today, and I don't remember, I think it was an MDOT letter, but it might have been something in one of the previous studies, or recent studies, actually. And that letter said that the Shore Road project could be accomplished with no takings. So I'm not in favor of, I'm extremely reluctant in any case to take someone's property. And my understanding is if we did this, there would be zero takings on Shore Road. Another thing we looked at, when we looked at Mr. Berry's property, I guess it's no secret, I'm pretty sensitive to cutting trees and old growth and that kind of thing. And it's my, I got out there with a tape, and it's my belief that his trees would be perfectly safe from this project. They're 10, 12 feet from the road. And so I would be reluctant to haphazardly go around cutting people's trees, even if some of them are in the town's right-of-way. It's not something I would take very lightly. And I think in that particular instance, Mr. Berry is watching at home. I think his trees are quite safe, even if this passes.
Thank you, Councilor.
Councilor Coxall? Yes, I'm a little uncomfortable having a council member guaranteeing someone that a tree or something is safe, because we do not know exactly where the road falls in the highway right-of-way. And so I think it's not wise for us to say that if this project is done according to the requirements of the federal government or the MDOT, that their property is protected, because we don't know that for a fact.
Well, I guess, thank you. My sense is that regardless of where the right-of-way is by Mr. Berry's house, unless this proposed plan was at least doubled, which I don't think anyone's proposed here tonight or any other time, his trees wouldn't be touched. And that's the only representation I made. I just went out there with a tape measure.
I'm sure if any project were being approved by the council, we would have full survey information and would most likely have information from our town arborist relative to trees. Any other councilor comments? Councilor Jordan?
Yes, I'd just like to, I feel, clear up something when they speak about this tree will be left and that one will be there. I haven't heard yet, definitely, whether we're talking 4 feet or 2 feet. We're just discussing options or possibilities. So I don't think the people should go home feeling that it's going to be a 4 foot or a 2 foot until we nail it down.
Thank you, Council. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I just, in case Mr. Berry is watching at home, and I've had a lot of discussions over the years with Mr. Berry, and while it may be true, Councilor, now we wouldn't, with the plan, affect the trees themselves. I know from other work we've done in that area, those trees have a very extensive root system.
And while we may not be touching the trees, we probably would be getting into the root system.
Thank you.
Again, the manager is not the town arborist, and we will be the town arborist. Counselor Cogswell?
No, I was just pointing to Mr. Bayross.
Mr. Bayross, you want to come up to the microphone, please?
Addressing Mr. Jordan's question, the ash tow specification is 4 feet at the present time. There's been some discussion about them going to a 5-foot standard, and it has to be on both sides of the road to be approved for federal funding. As far as the standard as it's written, and as far as the standard that we could consider in our discussions, whether they would modify that, as Rosemary has suggested, we did not explore with them.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bayross.
And I'd just like, if I may add a comment, Mr. Berry's front lawn, you know for sure that the paved part of the road is actually in the center of the right-of-way, or is it kind of to one side or the other? Nobody knows until you do some surveying what will happen to his trees.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Any other comments from councilors? At this point, the council is faced with a situation of needing to vote on two grant proposals, whether or not to proceed with those proposals to the Maine Department of Transportation. The vote on that needs to take place by the end of September, presumably at the council's September meeting on September 9th. September 9th. I'm seeing. The council does at this time have a workshop scheduled for August 28th, at which time it will be discussing all of the public hearing items from this evening, the report, the bikeway proposal for Shore Road, and the bikeway proposal for Two Lights Road. That is what it's looking like. I would like to remind all concerned that the Pedals and Pedestrian Planning Committee was an advisory committee to the council, as so many of our ad hoc committees are. We take their report, and then there is generally council discussion. Sometimes we have it before a public hearing, sometimes we have it after a public hearing. I think this time it seems like I feel well served by having had the public hearing before the council has its workshop, and certainly invite the public to attend the workshop. It is not usual to take comments from the public at a workshop, however. I'd like to hear the wishes of the council this evening on how you want to proceed. If you're in concurrence with putting to vote in September after the workshop, or if you have any other preferences. Councilor Reed?
I'll make a motion that we set this to workshop on August 28th with a final vote on the September 9th meeting.
Second.
Council discussion on that? We're assuming you meant items 48, 49, and 50.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes, also.
Seeing no discussion, all those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? Councilor Jordan, I didn't get a...
Oh, I had her up there.
Oh, I missed.
I'm getting old and I can't hold it too long.
Yeah, I'll look that way first the next time. 7-0 in favor of the motion. Thank you for your input this evening, folks. We do have other items on our agenda. Next item, item number 51, receipt of the paper street study. Let's just wait a minute for the hall to clear. Try to do that quietly.
Old school.
All right, Mr. McGovern, almost did it. Could you tell us something about the paper street study, please?
Yes, several years ago, the Maine legislature passed a statute indicating the communities had to decide by September 29, 1997, what they wanted to do with all the paper streets in the community. We were unsure exactly what we had for paper streets, and a lot of what you see here, the most extensive part of the work was simply doing the inventory of where they are. We worked with the Greater Portland Council of Governments. They spent an awful lot of time in at the Registry of Deeds, actually looking at every subdivision that was ever filed in the town of Cape Elizabeth to see if in fact, there were any paper streets in them anyway. They found 51. We went on a couple of different bus tours, one with department heads, another one with conservation commission, and made recommendations as to which paper streets ought to be retained after 1997 and which ones might be looked at, excuse me, to be kept by the community. We have a report that, you know, needs some attention, needs some looking at. I think it's a good report. I think Todd did a good job, and I want to thank them and Maureen O'Meara, the department heads, and the Conservation Commission for their work on it. I'd suggest you put it off to a workshop, and you know, I think we can have a good discussion at that point as to how it ought to proceed.
Thank you. Having been involved in a similar inventory in an adjacent community, I know how much work this is, and this is the graphic representation is something I'm going to copy, actually, for another community. I'm curious, however, if any of the utility companies were involved in the evaluation today.
Very, very cursory. They need to be discussed with, again, obviously the sewer lines, but beyond that, you know, whether Bob Malley did a lot of the work where he knew there were water lines that we know where they are. But, you know, obviously, before this proceeded too far, we'd do another check with them. We also have, by the way, a notebook. What you got here was a summary. We have a notebook about that thick with all the background material. We have also not, as of yet, sent a mailing out to everyone who has a paper street abutting their property. We don't want to get them excited before. But we did order more than enough reports to have a very wide distribution.
I think it would serve the council well if we had comments from the utility companies prior to a workshop on this. I would also, has the Conservation Commission and the Land Trust been involved in this so far?
The Conservation Commission has been extensively involved. We have not asked any private group. Which includes the Land Trust.
I got that. Councilor Coxall?
Yes, have we projected any possible future sewer line easements that we might need when you were considering those utility possibilities?
We looked at all those type things. We looked at pathways, we looked at potential sewer lines, we looked at potential water lines, potential roads, anything we could.